All right, we want to modify just slightly the approach that we have taken to talk about two colorable planar graphs. So in a two colorable graph, recall when we discussed chromatic number that you can characterize two colorable graphs by the absence of odd cycles. So if I have a two colorable planar graph with n greater than or equal to 3 vertices and Q edges, then Q is smaller. If you can't have odd cycles, then the upper bound 3n minus 6 becomes smaller and it drops down to 2n minus 4. Now, I'm not going to prove this result for you. The proof is exactly the same as in the original case, except you don't have any odd cycles. So when you're looking at a face in the drawing, and you see a face like this, and you count the edges around it, that number will always be even because there are no odd cycles. So your count begins with F4 and then F6 and then F8, etc. You have no F3s. So if you take the slide in the last lecture that does the analysis of the original bound and just replace all the face sizes with the even ones, you will get this slightly improved bound for two colorable planar graphs. Now, what's the application? The application is to the complete bipartite graph K33. If you look at K33, it's obviously two colorable, red on one side, blue on the other. The complete bipartite graph is two colorable. It has 6 vertices, 3 on each side, but it has 9 edges, 9, 3 times 3. But it can't be planar because 9 is bigger than 2n minus 4 when n is 6. 2 times 6 is 12, 12 minus 4 is 8, 9 is bigger than 8. So the complete bipartite graph K33 is non-planar. Now, I will bet money that the vast majority of you at some point have seen the puzzle problem where your friend or a magazine or your teacher or somebody says, look, I have 3 houses and I have 3 utilities. 3 houses, gas, water, and electricity, utility, connect each of the houses to each of the utilities without crossing lines. How many of you have seen that puzzle? Yeah. But you can't do it. You can get all the lines, all the connections except one, and then try as you may, you cannot get the last one. But now we know why. The why comes from the fact that the complete bipartite graph, K33, is non-planar. So you can put these two statements together. If you want to verify that a graph is non-planar, it suffices to find a homeomorph of K5 or a homeomorph of the complete bipartite graph K33. Either of those provides a certificate that the given graph is non-planar. Is that clear? Okay. And now, let's take this make it into a formal theorem. It's a theorem of Kuratowski that dates all the way back to 1930. A graph is non-planar if and only if it contains a homeomorph of the complete graph K5 or a homeomorph of the complete bipartite graph K33. And I comment at the bottom that there are highly efficient algorithms for planarity testing. In other words, you're given the input data for a graph in the same form that we have discussed before, just a text file that describes the edges. These algorithms will accept that data, and they will do one of two things. After a short and very, very short running time, they will tell you where to locate the vertices in the plane so that if you draw straight line segments connecting those pairs which are adjacent, you will get a drawing with no edge crossings. Or they will tell you that the graph is non-planar, and they will produce the certificate, which will either be a homeomorph of K5 or a homeomorph of K33. Now, these algorithms are beyond the level of Math 3012. They use advanced data structures. So for you computer science type, they use what are called PQ trees. And that's a little too, well, not a little, it's a lot too technical for this level of course. But I want you to know that these algorithms exist. And I also want you to know that, in fact, it is an ongoing area of research today, in that people are trying to get it to tweak and make it a little bit faster than their competitor. Because laying out a planar graph on a grid is the kind of problem that comes up all the time in circuit design, in VLSI layout, and in other problems, even down to the issue of how do you lay out a circuit on a microchip. You have this teeny tiny little thing, and you're going to place thousands, maybe millions of things at various positions on this chip. And it's very important that they have access, because on a chip you don't have wires or connections that are overlaying each other like that. So those layout issues are very important, and your ability to do them quickly remains an important applied problem. So for our course, what are you supposed to know? You're supposed to know that these algorithms exist. I haven't in any way pretended to explain the algorithms to you. But you're also supposed to know the theoretical result, that a graph is planar if and only if it contains a if it does not contain a homeomorph of the complete graph K5 or the complete bipartite graph K33. All right, now with this information in hand, we fully understand modulo some mysterious algorithms, exactly what constitutes a planar graph. Now we wanted to talk about some additional combinatorial properties. In particular, we want to talk about the maximum clique size and the chromatic number. Well, maximum clique size, this is easy. If you have a planar graph, the maximum clique size is 1 if there are no edges. It's 2 if there is an edge but no triangles. It's 3 if there's a triangle and no K4. And it's 4 if there's a K4. And you can test for a K4 pretty quickly by picking up the vertices 4 at a time and seeing if they form a K4. You don't have to go any further, because there are no K5s, 6s, 7s, etc. The maximum clique size is one of the first 4 positive integers. That's easy. All right, now, what is the chromatic number? All of a sudden, this becomes hard. And I've let the cat out of the bag by just telling you what the theorem is. The theorem is, if a graph is planar, then it can be 4-colored. The chromatic number is at most 4. And this is called the 4-color theorem. And it has a history which is, well, it's, I say 100 years. It's much, much older than that.